skin. Run, 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 but you sure can't hide. Well, nobody's interested in learning but the teacher. Segregation, determination, demonstration, integration, aggravation, humiliation, obligation to my nation.
Good morning. Welcome to Detroit Wants to Know. This week, we're coming to you from the TULC, the Trade Union Leadership Council, on Grand River Avenue in Detroit. My friends, people have filed for election. It's over. The filing deadline is over, and it's on and popping. We're going to start off with one of our CEO candidates, Wayne County CEO candidates, Mayor Bill Wild of Westland. Mayor Wild, welcome to the TULC and Detroit Wants to Know.
Well, glad to be here, Steve. Thanks for having me on your show today.
Well, I'm glad you're here, but I've got to ask you a question.
Sure.
Scrapyards. Your family has a scrapyard. Is it one or two?
I own one scrapyard in the city of Wayne. It's called Scrap Busters.
Scrap Busters that you own in the city of Wayne. Clear this up for me.
Sure.
Did you or did you not oppose the legislation in Lansing that clamped down on scrapyards?
I supported the bill, and I support Mike Duggan for what he did. I think it's an important bill. When I can tell you, as the mayor of the city of Westland, I face some of these same issues in Westland. We've had people cut our locks and our fences. They've cut catalytic converters off my senior bus. So we have the same issues in the city of Westland. I support the bill. The one thing I want to clear up, though, Steve, is that my business is called Scrap Busters, but we're not a scrapyard. We're an automotive recycling facility. My business, all we do is we buy vehicles and we recycle them. We don't buy catalytic converters. We don't buy aluminum. We don't buy copper. We don't buy that kind of stuff. We never have. It's just not our business. But I appreciate Mike Duggan for stepping up to the plate. And you know the thing I really like about him is that he got in his car and he went to Lansing himself and he got that thing done. So I appreciate that.
Well, the thing I like about him is that he actually drives himself, which is like really interesting to me. Tell me about your family. Tell me about you. Who are you?
Well, Steve, I'm 45 years old. I'm a Democrat. I'm the mayor of the city of Westland.
Say that one more time. You are a Democrat, because some people have said you're actually a Republican in Democrat's clothes.
Oh, well, I'm a proud Democrat, Steve, and you know, a lot of people don't think that you can be a business-minded Democrat. The Democrats can't work good, they're not good at balancing budgets.
Mm-hmm.
I've done that in the city of Westland. I've worked with my unions, but you know, besides being the mayor and besides owning a business, we just celebrated our 25th anniversary, actually, at our business. You know, I'm a proud father. My wife, Sherry, she's a teacher. She's a sixth grade science teacher in Farmington. I've got three little kids, a son who's 11 named Luke, who's just a heck of a hockey player, mm-hmm. and two little girls, Lily and Peyton, 9 and 7. So, you know, I've got a pretty full plate, but I enjoy watching the kids and I try to spend as much time with them as I can. And you'll usually see me at the end of the day at one of the hockey rinks around town watching my son play hockey.
Okay. Tell me about your educational background.
You know, I grew up in the city of Westland. I went to John Glenn High School, public school. My wife, Sherry, and I both went there. And after that, I went on to was studying towards a business degree, went to U of M Dearborn, and then actually at the age of 19, had the opportunity to go into business with my dad. And, you know, I started towards my business degree, got that opportunity, and I've been in business ever since.
So then you have not finished college?
You know, I think all of us still have some goals, and I've got some goals I'm still trying to accomplish, but one of them is going back to get that degree. But I can tell you that what I have done is by studying business, it gave me that opportunity to go into business with my dad. Mm-hmm. I've just celebrated my 25th anniversary as a business owner here in Wayne County. And I can tell you that what I've learned in business as a business owner, I brought that to the mayor's office in the city of Westland. And it's been a tremendous help to me. And now I think that...
Well, let's put that to the test.
Okay.
How many years of a balanced budget have you had in Westland?
I've been mayor for 7 years. We've had a balanced budget every year. And I can tell you that 2 weeks ago, I presented the city of Westland's first 3-year balanced budget that has a $5.5 million surplus.
Okay. In a down economy with real estate values falling, you've had a balanced budget every year, plus this new budget you're going to have is a $5 million surplus. You're going to need that, Mayor Wild. When we come back, I want to talk about how you're going to use your experience to turn around the finances at Wayne County. Are you ready for that?
I'm ready for it.
I'm telling you, I know Wayne County finances. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back with Mayor Bill Wild, CEO candidate. Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. We're coming to you from the TULC on Grand River this week in Detroit. My guest is Mayor Bill Wild. Mayor Bill Wild, businessman. Tell me, how in the world are you going to turn around Wayne County's finances?
Well, we're going to do the same thing we did in the city of Westland, Steve. We're going to lay out the numbers. And one of the things that they do at the county is that they just look at a one-year model. In the city of Westland, what we did, we stretched out to a five-year model. Mm-hmm. And once we actually saw those numbers, that's when we sat down with our unions. When we did that five-year model is when we saw that the city of Westland was going to have, in this current year, 2014, a $50 million deficit. Mm-hmm. And now I said we got a $5.5 million surplus. Once you look at the real numbers and you share them with people and you're willing to make some sacrifices at the top, shared sacrifices, mm-hmm. that's how you get buy-in, and that's what we're going to have to do at the county. It's a $2 billion a year budget. They got a $200 million deficit, or structural deficit. It's going to take more than just Bill Wild to turn around Wayne County. It's going to take relationships with the other elected officials from Wayne County and with the unions. But we're going to do it. We're going to do it just like we did in the city of Westland. We lost 40% of our property values in Westland. We got our state shared revenue cut, but we worked within our means. We did it without asking residents for a bunch of new millages, without going to war with their unions, and we did it without cutting services. So okay. We've got a formula that works.
You said you had to work with other electeds. We had Wayne County Prosecutor Worthy on the show a couple weeks ago, and she had some pretty scathing things to say about Mr. Ficano and his deficit elimination plan and all that stuff and how it actually hurt. I think she said something about, child molesters, robbers, something like that.
Yeah.
We're friends of Bob Ficano. It's kind of rough. Yeah. What are you going to do to help the prosecutor's office?
Well, the one thing I want to say is that I think we're very fortunate. I think we've got the best prosecutor in Wayne County in the entire country. And I'm not just saying that to curry favor with her. When you talk with her, and anybody talks with her, you can see the fire in her belly. You can see the passion. I've known the prosecutor for several years. I've got a working relationship with her already as a mayor. What I would do is first of all, that's when you heard those comments she made, that is a fractured relationship. Mm-hmm. If the current county executive,
I'd say it's fractured.
If the current county executive is reelected, that's not going to fix that relationship.
She said child molesters were her friends. If that's not fractured, I don't know what is.
So now I can tell you as a mayor, I understand the importance of public safety, and I'm going to sit down with the prosecutor, and we've already started talking about how we could do that. I believe she needs more prosecutors. We got to figure out a way to get these rape kits caught up. When you just think about how far we've fallen behind on that, mm-hmm. it's deplorable. So I'm going to work with her. I believe it starts with relationship. I've talked with her about shared sacrifice. She says she hasn't seen that in the past. Mm-hmm. She wants a one-on-one relationship with the CEO. She doesn't want that relationship delegated to a, you know, mm-hmm. one of the deputies. So I think that we'd be looking to start a brand new relationship. We'd sit down. I believe in public safety, so I believe that we. Would be a good team, very formidable team.
Okay, as a person that used to be a Wayne County appointee and benefited from the largesse at the county, what are you going to do about your appointee ranks? Are you going to have this big cadre of do-nothing people? Actually, I did something. But
yeah, I know you did. You did a great job. Well, I can tell you, that's when you talk about shared sacrifice, that's where it starts, and that's where we started in Westland. When I asked my unions, I said, we're going to have to downsize our operations. And I told them, I had 18 appointees. We cut that down to 12, so I took out a third of my appointees. Six bodies saved us $1 million a year. Mm-hmm. They say the current county executive has between 150 and 200 appointees. Mm-hmm. So imagine if we use that same formula, what we could do there. And that's the kind of shared sacrifice. And when you talk about that deficit reduction plan, it doesn't even talk about any of those positions. So that's mm-hmm. where we should be starting. If for nothing else, it sends the right message to your unions that you're serious. It sends a message to the state of Michigan that you're serious.
Okay. Well, we're going to see. I'm going to talk to you later on in the summer as this campaign unfolds. I've got to talk to all your competitors, too, because okay. of SEC regulations. And we're going to see how each one of you can actually get out from under what looks like the state's boot that is coming. Okay. Mayor Wild, thanks for joining us at the TULC.
Thank you, Steve.
And hang out in Detroit.
All right, keep up the good work.
By the way, I hear you have Skip Mongo on your team. Is that good? You got Skip Mongo?
I do. He's doing a great job for me. Thank you.
He's wild. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back with my good friend Ken Coleman. We're going to give you another take on the Steve Utash beating. Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. We're coming to you from the TULC on Grand River in Detroit. My friends, we had a horrible beating some weeks back of a motorist that accidentally hit a young man. And he was beaten afterwards, and fortunately he's recovering now. A lot of people were quick to jump and say this is a hate crime, this was racially motivated. I'm here to tell you, if I had done the same thing, if many of you had done the same thing, we would have had the same outcome. And with me, my truck would have gotten stolen. I'm here to tell you, my friends, that there's an undercurrent of rage in Detroit, Michigan right now that if allowed to go unchecked, I believe will boil over. And to talk about this, I have my good friend Ken Coleman, historian. Ken, welcome this
Pleasure.
Morning.
Pleasure.
I maintain that the same feeling of rage and despair that was present in 1967 before the Detroit riots is present in Detroit right now. I say that because of the merchant consumer problems we're having with the liquor stores, some of the gas stations, some Metro PCSs, mm-hmm. and the Utash killing is just like a further, beating, yeah. is a further confirmation. That. Tell us about what led up to that 1967 riot. What was the mood of Detroit at that point in time?
Well, thanks for having me on, Steve. Certainly in beginning in the 1960s, early 1960s, you had a growing black community. Detroit's population was about twice the size it is now. It's about 1.5 million people mm-hmm. By the 60s. The black population was growing, but there were very few opportunities for African Americans to have positions of leadership downtown. Mm-hmm. Of course, your dad was elected to the member of the Detroit City Council,
right.
Common Council then in 1965. Mm-hmm. Bill Patrick several years before him, but obviously we didn't have an African American in the office of mayor. So, lack of political power, economic deprivation, although the Great Society programs were just beginning to hit urban cities like Detroit, there was still a lot of reaction to white supremacy, and some of it was rage, and it culminated in the rebellion in 1967.
Okay, well, we have economic strife here in Detroit.
Sure.
Our power, our political power, has been basically decimated by the governor and the emergency manager. Mm-hmm. They say it's coming back, but there will be advisory boards covering everything. I even had a judge text me the other night saying he was followed and profiled on Belle Isle.
Wow.
A judge, a sitting probate judge.
Yeah.
Okay. What is different between today and then?
Well, I mean, certainly you do have, situations where you do have more African Americans in positions of leadership in City Hall and the like. But those economic challenges are still there. The deprivation is still there. I think there's an element of rage that's still there. You hate to go out and predict things and say that the mood is mm-hmm. right for another rebellion, but we've all seen pockets of the city where it is worse than it was in 1967. I just drove part of the old West Side today, this morning, mm-hmm. and you remember what those communities looked like 40 and 50 years ago when we were
right.
kids.
Mm-hmm.
There's lots of deprivation, there's lots of rage.
Okay, what do we do to turn it?
Well, I think good things can happen from unfortunate situations like Steve Utash. I mean, several years ago, we saw a group of black men come together in Detroit 300 and say, we're taking the streets back. There are situations in our history of Detroit where we've seen challenging occurrences go on and great things happen. Church movements, religious movements, social movements, New Detroit. Was a reaction to what happened in 1967, the coalition of whites and blacks, business owners and community residents and activists coming together to sort of build a new town. That we're going to need more of that in Detroit, and the interesting thing will be how do we sort of work in a situation where now we have the first white mayor in the city in 40 mm-hmm. years, how will he react to situations like Utash. We've seen early what he came out and denounced it, but that's going to be a challenge.
It's going to be a challenge, and we also had a white mayor in 67.
It's true.
Just just saying. We got to go to break and then talk about the TULC. Tell us about your book. Where can we get it?
I appreciate it. The book is available on our website, www.onthisdaydetroit.com, and available at amazon.com as an ebook.
All right, great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ken.
Thank you, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back. You're going to learn about the TULC and its importance and vibrance in this city. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the TULC. My guests are Gerald Bantam, a trustee with the TULC, and John Rucker, a trustee with the TULC. Gentlemen, I know about the Hustle Night. I've actually come and watched the herd move. I know about the fabulous chicken wings, and you have ballroom night here. But the TULC is much more than that. Mr. Bantam, tell me about it. Why is the TULC? We sit in front of all these pictures of all these labor leaders. Great Coleman Young is staring at me over there. Why the TULC?
Well, the TULC started back in the mid-50s, and it was started by two of the gentlemen that you see on a particular wall, Buddy Battles and also Horace Sheffield. Both those particular gentlemen were auto workers.
And that would be Senior.
Senior Horace Sheffield.
Yes.
And Buddy Battles III. And both were labor leaders that saw a need in starting an organization to help the community. Primarily help the community as far as getting minorities and women involved in the trades.
Okay.
You know, and also helping the minorities get themselves involved in getting to better jobs within the city, better jobs within the United Auto Workers.
Okay. Mr. Rucker, does the TULC still serve a purpose today?
The TULC will always serve a purpose, okay? But you have to remember, as Gerald just stated, when the TULC just got started, the programs that was put on here at the TULC, like a pre-apprenticeship training, getting minority trained to get into the trades, the labor movement and the company hadn't negotiated pre-apprenticeship program. And this was the only outreach that our people's membership had to get the pre-apprenticeship training. They got it right here at the TULC.
Really? Now see, I never knew that. I just looked at it as a gathering place to make political deals, to network and all that. But you're telling me you actually held pre-apprentice training here?
Oh, absolutely.
Years ago?
Absolutely. When we first got started, there were a number of people, I mean, skilled trades training, apprenticeship trainings, like John said, teaching women how to do a lot of things that they used to do in schools, and they no longer they cut those particular programs out. All this came about through the TULC.
If you talk to anyone that's a tradesperson that's been in the trade for, well, some older person, and most of them will tell you, oh yeah, I got my training right here at the TULC. I got the training to get into the trades.
Okay. What's the future of the TULC?
Well, we hope that the future of the TULC is great. We're down here now trying to make sure and maintain the TULC because we want our particular people to understand exactly where they came from in order for people to know exactly where they're going. You know, there's a lot of people that come in and out of the city of Detroit. We've tried to bring them to the TULC. We try to give them the history of the TULC, the pictures of the wall, the Jackie Robinsons, the A. Philip Randolphs, the Coleman Youngs. You know, we want to maintain the TULC. We like the TULC to be able to go back and do some of the things they were doing in the first stages of the TULC.
Mr. Rucker, how do people become members of the TULC?
Well, it's easy to become a member. We have a membership drive where you just come in and pay your membership dues. You can become a member of the club. Membership fee for seniors run from $15, and from $15 to $40. That's the membership.
Okay, and they can come down. What's the address here?
8670
Grand River. So come down any day after 5?
Absolutely.
Any day after 5 and come get a membership?
Absolutely.
Okay, gentlemen, you've educated me. I didn't know you all did apprenticeship programs here. I'm going to tell you one of the things that's lacking in Detroit right now is the lack of apprenticeship training.
No question.
It's lacking right now. We've got all these houses being torn down and no way. We got a bridge that may be built and no way to feed people in to those skilled trades. So just like we were saying in the segment before, the clock has been turned back again. You guys, you all have to do that again. Ladies and gentlemen, we've had an interesting week here. We had Mayor Bill Wild, we had Ken Coleman talking about RAGE, and we learned about the TULC. I urge you to come down and get a membership. That address again?
8670 Grand River.
8670 Grand River, any day after 5 o'clock. Come on down, get a membership. They're inexpensive. Let's rebuild Detroit. Have a great week.
People moving out, people moving in. Why? Because of the color of the skin.
Run, 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 but you sure can't hide.